Good afternoon. My name is Singa Atua from the NRF. I see familiar faces, probably two or three. So, yeah, that should calm my nerves down. I'm with Lutandani and Tricia. I don't know if you've seen her before. Today, we're going to be talking about the review process. But some of you are familiar with it. I know probably there's a number of questions that you already have for us. So we're also open to that grilling session going forward. Okay, this is now quick. So basically, this is what we're going to be touching on. Most importantly, the eligibility criteria, how to prepare a proposal, important call dates, etc. We are from the Reviews and Evaluation Directorate. I'm only going to be concentrating on the review process processes because it's our directorate is actually divided into two. The reviews one section and evaluation is actually, even though we are under the same umbrella. So probably the evaluation, Tricia, is the evaluation people going to be coming to do their own presentation?
Oh, yeah, they did last week.
They did last week. Mm. Oh, that is perfect. Wow. Objectives of funding instruments. We're not going to talk about all the funding instruments that we have. We have quite a number of them. Paul, when you visit the NRF website, you've seen them. It's a whole list like this. But basically, the objectives, the overall objectives of each funding instrument, we're supporting research. From emerging researchers, young researchers, up to rated researchers or highly qualified, internationally recognized researchers. So basically, that is the objective of the NRF, to support the development of research in South Africa and to foster a culture of excellence in research. We also encouraging those demographic compositions when we look at which proposals do we find in terms of gender, race, and persons with disabilities, because it's important that we focus on those so that we can try and promote or help, I would say, mostly black female researchers, for instance, to also penetrate the market, or the research market, and grow in that part. Important call dates. Like I said, there's a number of funding instruments that are advertised. We start advertising the call dates the previous year prior to calls coming out. In this instance, we'll be probably sending out information about call dates. Is it in December, November, the previous year for the next, for the next year, for the coming year? So from March, we normally advertise calls, and they normally close somewhere in August, the latest, which actually gives us a very short period of time to prepare for reviews and get the funding decisions out. But it's what we do in the review section, so it's our job. We try and meet the deadlines set forth. For more information on where and how to find the call dates as advertised per funding instrument, you can go to the website as listed below. Eligibility criteria differs from funding instrument to funding instrument. Here, we just put the Tutuga program as an example so that we can just focus on one funding instrument so that we can get at least an idea of what is it that we're looking for when we talk about eligibility criteria. For instance, We would say we only want South African researchers to apply under the age of 45. They need to be holding a PhD, registered at a certain public university in South Africa, and so forth. But we're not limited to these eligibility criteria, because not only in the review section we're dealing with Tutuga, but also dealing with bilaterals, the African partnership programs, international partnership programs, which have a set of different criteria which will be embedded in a call document so that applicants can look at that and see if they qualify depending on their research needs at that point in time. So this will also be touching on, say now this person is applying for a PhD track in Tutuga, these will be a set of criteria that they will need to be adhering to as they are applying another track. And so is the NRF rating track. So basically, then you'll find that there will be set a different criteria as per funding instrument that you need to be applying for. Preparing a proposal, you guys are probably familiar with that because when you apply, that's what you do. You make sure that you visit the website, you get the court documents there as they are posted to see what is that is expected of you as you are preparing a proposal. It's important to read the documents. We know that the framework is just a summary of what is it that call requires, but we normally attach also the program manual, which is now a detailed version of the program framework, so that you can have a better understanding of what that instrument is about. But we know we don't have time to read, so sometimes we find that our researchers out there, they will call us to ask us some questions. But I want to find that the questions actually answered in the manual. So we would encourage our applicants out there to please, as much as they are getting the call framework, they can also look at the program manual so that you can get further details in terms of what is it that is required for that funding instrument. This is important, I suppose. When let's say, put yourself in the shoes of a proposal reviewer, because we call in a team of experts to come and review the proposals. So they will be coming with their expert opinions in terms of how to write a proposal, how to present your scientific and technical merits of your proposal. So they'll be coming as unbiased as possible, they'll be transparent. So as you're writing your proposal, it will be actually a nice thing to think as you're sitting, if I were to be reviewing my own proposals, what is it that I'll be looking at, concentrating at? Research methodology, very important, because those are some of the criteria that we look at. It should be explicit, it should be clear, what is it that you want to do and how are you going to go about doing it. The aims, we normally find that the reviewers will say no, but yes, we understand the research problem. We understand what this particular applicant is willing to achieve, but what the research aims are actually detailing, it's not realistic. It's not something that can be attained probably in a period of 3 years, for instance, as would be the research project time frame. The budget is also an issue, even though it's our issue as the NRF to look at the budget, but if the budget is not talking to the aims of the project, it becomes a problem when it comes to funding decisions, because the person will be saying, but I requested a million rand budget and we've cut it up to maybe 30,000, I'm just making an example, and a person will not understand what happened to the chunk of the budget that they requested. It's important not to inflate the budget. Must be realistic. It must also accompanied by motivation of each item, why do you need that budget, and how is it going to help your proposal to flourish in the period of probably 3 years, if that's what you apply for. This is also very important, the literature review. Some would say, but the NRF didn't really point out on the core document that we should be concentrating on listing references or showing that we've done the literature survey or something like that. But as the researcher, it's important that you are comprehensive without us actually conveying it to you to say, please detail your literature survey, make it as comprehensive as possible. And if it's possible, list all your references. If you can't list all of them in the application because they said, but the characters didn't allow us, probably make an attachment, send it through with your proposal so that we can be able to be in a position to see that, okay, this person actually did visit the literature and they were comprehensive enough. I think that is what stands out again most of the time when we review these proposals. Collaborations and team members in the collaboration space. I think this is very important because if yes, you're collaborating, but if you're not demonstrating to us what is the role of the PI, what is the role of each of the collaborating team members, it's making it difficult for us when you're probably in the budget, there's something that you requested in connection with what the team will be doing. It's difficult for us to ascertain that, okay, this particular budget that you've requested will actually be assisting the project in this way because this member and that member will be involved in doing 1, 2, 3. So if that can also be detailed enough for the NRF to make a judgment, it would also add advantage to your proposal as it gets reviewed. So this is a core process probably that you're really familiar with. What I should really concentrate on here is updating the CV on NRF submission. Researchers are asked to please keep updating their CVs regularly because as they apply, obviously some of the information that is in their CV gets pulled out into the application. So you find that there's a lot of administration when you're completing your application. So if your CV is not updated, then there's another set of detailed tasks that you need to do completing your CV whilst you need to be completing your application. So it will be important. It's important to keep on updating your CV so that through the time comes you need to be applying, it's easy, information gets pulled out into your application. One other thing that is also important in this space is the screening for eligibility. This is done at institution by the research office. We're getting a lot of, I would say, not so comfortable challenges here because you'll find that applicants are somewhat lazy. That is a wrong word. Not lazy. Let's say they were pressed for time and they couldn't finish their applications on time. Then they put pressure on the institution here when they're submitting their applications at midnight prior to the closing date, which makes it difficult for these guys here to check for the eligibility of the application. And then the application goes through to the NRF after the system closes. Then it's here. Oh. Okay, so this was the research office screen. I don't know where I was. Right, so but then now, internal processing. Right, this is us now. Sorry about that. So this will be us here. Internal processing for content. Oh, I was going the other direction. I'm so sorry, guys. All right, this would have been the slide, the part that I was talking about, screening at the research office. This is us here, screening for eligibility. When it gets here, now this is where we come in. As the NRF, we screen all the applications that are coming through, looking at the eligibility criteria for each funding instrument. So you'll find that because things were not submitted here, when it comes to there, now the applicants will be asking if NRF could give them more time to submit their documents, so that probably supporting documents for the application, so that it can go through for review. This is putting so much pressure on us as the NRF, because not only it tells the time that we already do not have, but it also makes it difficult, because sometimes, because of the time constraints, you'll find some of the applications worm their way through to the review, and then they get rejected there because they don't have supporting documents, they don't really meet the eligibility criteria. So we urge our applicants out there to please make sure that they complete their applications in time, supply all the supporting document as is needed, as is necessary for the funding instrument, and then when they send for screening at the research office, it's complete, so that when it comes to us here, we don't have problems, and the application can just go through to the review section. Should the application get rejected, obviously we inform the institution to say we can't accept these applications for review, and life goes on after that. So this will be the evaluation process. Applications are accepted for two phased reviews. In other words, we have, I'll make an example, the Tutuga program is a two-phased review. What happens there, we send applications out for postal review, or what we call remote reviews. So we also seek experts out there to help us review the proposals. That will be your peers. Mostly it's the ones that you guys suggest, because we would ask that you give us the six names of the reviewers that you think who are your peers, you think they will help you review your proposal. And on top of that, we also identify additional reviewers to also assist with reviewing that application. So what happens is, as they bring in their reports, we are mandated to also check those reports, the quality of the reports. Sometimes the reports are biased, because obviously if you have requested your friend to review your application, they are bound to be flowery, you know, biased, and sugarcoat some of the truth about your application. But we make sure that we also identify postal reviewers that are independent from, you know, you as the applicant and us as the NRF, so that we can have a balance between the ones that you suggested and the ones that we suggest. Then we'll take the report and assess the quality of those reports. Should we feel that, okay, we can use these reports, then we file them somewhere. Then they will help us as the process goes. Because at the end of the day, we'll have to feedback back to the applicant to say, your application didn't make the cut because of 1, 2, 3, and also our reviewers have supported a recommendation for funding or a recommendation not to fund your proposal. And the process goes now to reviews. Then we, like I have explained, we will use those reports for that purpose. But for the ones that we do not require postal reviews, they go straight to the panel meeting. In other words, we simply identify panel members, as some of you have been at the NRF reviewing the applications. We identify panel members who are experts in the field. We invite them, they come and they assess the proposals. Then they will give their input. Then they will give their input, and as we document the comments, then those comments will be feedback back to the applicant. Now there's another move. The assessment process. Okay, I think I've touched a bit on the assessment process, poster reviews, da da da. But here is some of the criteria that we normally interrogate in the process. Track record of applicant, research proposal. Most the chunk of the sweat goes here. The scientific content of the proposal. If this is not satisfactory, it kills other criteria, as you can see, because most of the time this part here will have a bigger weighting. For instance, I would say sometimes it goes up to 45% of the overall 100% average for aggregate score for the proposal. So if this part here is not well articulated, it's not clear, panel members or viewers cannot get the gist of what you're trying to achieve with your proposal, chances are your proposal might not make it through. But should you be concentrating more on this, it does not necessarily mean then you have to learn here on other eligibility criteria, because they are also equally important depending on the needs of that funding instrument. Project management, collaboration, supervision, mentorship. Some also do not pay much attention to this part. Say now, the core requirement says you must have a supervisor report endorsing your application. I think it's the prerogative of the applicant to make sure that they get the necessary information, necessary support. If it's supposed to be a document accompanying the application from the supervisor, then they should make sure that they get such motivation and attach it. It's whether the supervisor was overseas, because we get all sorts of reasons why the supervisor did not support, the supervisor was not there, the supervisor was not paying attention. But at the end of the day, it's a responsibility of the applicant to make sure that they get supported in documentation so that we can be able to assess the application. Expected output, we also have challenges here because a person will not be detailed enough in terms of what is it that their research is expected to produce, the results expected to produce. This is very important because it tells us that you know exactly what your research will be achieving. And please, this part here needs to be somewhat realistic, because if it's also not realistic, experts out there can immediately see that this person is just, there's this word that they use, probably to come back to me. But it just means that this person is
fishing.
Thank you. Thank you. And that is not giving so much credit to the applicant because it just tells the experts that probably they don't know what this research is going to achieve, and it might really bring down the quality of their research. So saw is potential impact. Knowledge economy needs to be contributing to knowledge economy globally, nationally, and so forth. This is the part where now everything is done. We have our comments in front of us from our experts. And then when we do that, when we have everything, we consolidate all the comments from the reports that we talked about, from the comments that we took as the NRF during the meetings. We consolidate them. We make them as detailed as possible so that we can send them back to the applicant to say, well, you did good, and these were the results, or you did very, very bad because these are the results from your peers, this is what they say. Then after that, everything obviously gets signed off, and the outcome letters and detailed feedback is sent out to the applicants. So basically, that is as much as the process goes from A to Z.